worship if you'd like.
Rest of our days, yes.
our God, unto our God, matchless, endless, love unrestrained. This is our God, every tribe sing praise and glory, honor and strength. Unto our God, matchless, endless, love unrestrained. This is our God, every tribe sing ayo. Unto our God, matchless, endless, love unrestrained. This is our God, every tribe sing praise and glory, honor and strength. Unto our God, unto our God, matchless, endless, love unrestrained. This is our God, every tribe sing ayo.
Love that. When I think of worshiping, I think of the woman who came and broke the precious, valuable oil over Jesus' head, or another gospel over his feet. Just this unrestrained affection poured out to God. I try to put myself in that mindset when we worship, and that music helps. And can we just thank this worship band? This is their last time playing this year for us. Thank you. Thank you. Friday, we'll have a senior chapel, so it'll be all senior band members. This morning, we have our anchor preacher coming to preach to us. Friday is going to be all testimonies from seniors, but our anchor preacher, I love this pastor. This pastor is not a consumer of religious goods. She came to church 36 years ago as a college student, and has stayed in a variety of capacities and is now the senior pastor at the same church. And if you want to know street cred for a pastor, just say, yeah, I'm the pastor at Free Meth. That'll get you some street cred in a lot of places where maybe it shouldn't. But Colleen Hurley-Bates is one of my favorite partners in town. She just loves people in Jesus' name. She's the pastor over at Free Methodist Church up on the Mesa. She's mentored many of our interns and welcomed many of our students and faculty. And Colleen, we are so grateful that you're here. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me. It's always a joy to be here, and I love just coming and spending a little bit of time. Like many of you, I have very vivid dreams. Anyone here have vivid dreams? Like weirdo mishmash dreams of like weird people and weird circumstances. And I know I'm in Oregon, but I'm really always in my dreams at my childhood home, which makes me think I probably need therapy. And so I have these dreams. My husband has cool dreams about like saving the world. And I have these like weird dreams. And like the Lord never comes to me and says in my dream, I want you to go and do this. And I'm like, that's okay. You know, people have those. I don't have those until December. In December, I had a dream that I was here with you. Now, Dr. Lassay had already asked me to be here, but the Lord was like, I want you to go to, I'm going to cry. I want you to go to Westmont and I want you to share a little bit of your story, which I don't usually do. And I was like, yes, Lord, that is what I'm going to do. And so I received that. And so I'm here to tell you today just a little bit about my story. As we begin, I just want to talk a little bit about how important it is for us to tell our stories. Your story is unique and important. Your story has shaped your soul and your life. As people who follow Jesus, it's vital that we tell our stories because our stories bring glory to God and proclaims that God is faithful, that God is a truth teller, that God is purposeful and kind. Even when our stories are painful or we wrestle and we're not sure who God has been there for every part of our stories. Jesus impacted my life before I even knew him. And as I have gotten older, I have seen that Jesus has given me a life beyond anything that I could have ever imagined. And one astounding gift has been the way that my life has been anchored in God's word. Not of my own doing, lest I would come before you and boast about it. Scripture has been generously poured out over me, and it has brought stability to my life. So Dr. Lassaya mentioned anchors. Today we're going to talk about anchors for just a minute. I'm not a sailor, but there are some fascinating things to learn about anchors, especially if we think about how they are a metaphor for our life in Christ. Anchor, a heavy object attached to a rope or a chain, used to keep a water vessel in one place, usually with a hook that embeds itself in the bottom of a lake or the ocean. And as a verb, anchor means to secure firmly in position or to provide a firm foundation. So think about your life a little bit. This is kind of random, but think about your life as a boat. You are a boat, and God has designed you. And some of us are speedboats, and some of us are canoes. And some of us are submarines, and some of us are barges, and some of us are luxury cruise ships. But over time, God changes the lines and the capacity of our boat as we become like him. And then we are sent to the places where we serve and make God known. So other boats can join the flotilla to go and to bring new life. And every day, we can spend time anchored to Jesus so that we can be filled up, so that we can have regular maintenance so that we can then go and embark on the daily adventure of serving God wherever it is we are meant to go. Hebrews 6 talks about this, how we have a covenant of God as a great hope. And in the section where the author is talking about God's promises to Abraham as a sure reality for all people, it says that God's word will serve as an anchor for our souls, firm and secure. So there are four stages of my life that I briefly want to tell you about as a way of thinking for you to think about your story, for you to think about how you are being sent to go and minister to others while you are being lovingly transformed as you have been lovingly created. So first, early life. I am the last of five children born to older parents. I always say best for last, and my siblings love that. My dad was flew airplanes in the Air Force and was gone a lot. And when I was born, my parents' marriage was disintegrating due to a lot of different factors. Alcoholism, unfaithfulness, loss of trust, not having great tools. Like a lot of people, My life was, early life was sad and hard. My mom left when I was 3 and my dad raised me. And until this time, my family was devout Catholic. They were deeply connected to their faith community. And when my parents divorced, my dad became very angry at God and refused to go to church anymore or to have anything to do with Jesus. So that meant that I didn't either. One of my favorite things to do, though, when I was quite little, was to go to the different houses in my neighborhood, to the older people, because they always had cookies and good conversation. And one of the ladies thought that I should learn about God, so she took me to catechism, a time of teaching at the church. And there I learned the Lord's Prayer. And she told me, say this prayer every day because it will keep you connected to Jesus. So let's say it together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I have a vivid memory of sitting in that classroom learning the Lord's Prayer. At an early age, God showed me how I could know him. He taught me that there's a bigger picture than my little life, that there's a whole world that he has made and that I'm supposed to be obedient to his will, that he taught me how I could be thankful even though my life had a lot of loneliness and difficulty. He taught me to be humble because everybody sins, but everybody can have forgiveness. And this prayer has been an anchor for me because it was my first connection to the living God. And I want you to think about what your first connection to God was through Scripture. What was your first connection and how did it teach you about God? When I was in elementary school, this is my second phase, when I was in the third grade, I met my best friend named Noelle on the monkey bars. Her family went to church and they invited me to come. And my dad was still angry with God. And he said, well, you can go if you keep your room clean and your grades up. You see, kids in America have to be bribed to go to church, usually, but I had to pay. My dad didn't want me to go, but he was willing to give me the freedom to explore God. And I want to tell you something here that I want you to remember, that people who are angry with God are closer to him than people who do not care. When we are angry, we are still engaged in the fight. Anger isn't anger. There's always something underneath it. In this case, it was hurt. So I want you to think about when you are angry, just in general. Think about what is underneath that. And that sometimes we want to have reconciliation, but we don't know how. Or our heart is hard, or we don't think that we can trust. My dad lost his trust in God, but his anger meant that he wanted relationship. But I didn't know that then. I loved church. I loved so many things about it. I loved the music and the people and the new way of knowing God. I felt like I had a new family who loved me and accepted me and taught me the truth and grace of Christ. Were they perfect? Heck no, it was the church. But sometimes, even though it was really good, it was hard for me that I didn't have my family there, and I wondered if I really belonged. So I want to tell you that if you have been going to church all your life, that from my perspective, you are blessed that people brought you there so that you could try to anchor to God. And if you are a church-going person, I want you to think about friends in your life who would benefit from having the kind of family that church offers. And if you are going to church and you don't have your family there, find spiritual mothers and fathers who will love you and mentor you and remind you that you are not alone. God builds the church by invitation, and we invite others because we have been invited. In this time, I was learning about how good and holy God is. And one scripture I learned with a bunch of children in Sunday school was this: trust in the Lord with all your heart and don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge God, submit to God, and he will make your path straight. You see, I was a strong child. I was a bossy child. I was an in-charge child. And God used this scripture to remind me, Colleen, you have to be more humble. You have to be more gentle of heart. And remember that I'm the one who's in control. I had to learn that I wasn't always right. I don't always know best. I still have to remember that. When we're young, it's good that we're taught this so that we can learn to be gracious and seek Jesus with all we are. Stop and think about a lesson that God has taught you from Scripture, maybe when you were in elementary school or sometime around there. My teenage years, I was 13 when I committed my life to Christ. We were at a big youth gathering, maybe kind of like a room like this. I don't remember very much about it, except it was dark. I don't remember who the preacher was, except he was an old white guy. And there were probably about 300 of us, and we were all sitting together, and God just spoke to me. God speaks to us, amen? And God just spoke to me and said, Colleen, this is the time I want you to follow me. So I went up to the altar. It wasn't emotional. I didn't cry. I think my counselor kept thinking that I was going to cry, and I really just didn't. But Jesus saved me at a pivotal time in my life. I had a lot of time on my own. I was starting to make choices that weren't great. I was kind of rebellious. I didn't have a lot of wisdom. But I knew that I had seen a lot of destructive behavior in my life. People messing up their lives because of their selfishness, people who didn't mean to but got lost in addiction, people just going their own ways and they weren't kind or healthy. And Jesus was offering me a different way. He was offering me a way out. He was offering me a way devoted to him where I could die to myself. And God made it possible then for me to walk with him every day. And I was thinking, in my dream, I literally thought, tell them how much God loves young people. God wants to meet us when we're young because he wants you to go and change the world. He wants to fill you with his power and his love. He wants you to go and use your gifts because the world is desperate. And Jesus wants you to go with him and make things good wherever you are. I was discipled by a great youth pastor. Every week, guys and girls would meet together with Watchem Nee and Bonhoeffer and all of the people, and we would just argue and encourage one another. I was given wisdom to sit down and learn from God's life, from God's word. We can't neglect that opportunity. It's too easy. Even as a pastor, sometimes I think, man, I'm not preaching this week. What am I doing with my life, right? Like, you got to think about how God wants you to stay close to him, because of the world, it's just too easy to come in and take us away. When I was 16, God spoke to me in a church service and asked if I would serve him with my life, kind of a sanctifying moment. I said yes, but I didn't know what that meant. And at the altar, I committed my life to whatever God wanted me to do. And at this time, God gave me a scripture, Philippians 1:6. For I'm confident of this very thing, that the God who began a good work in you will perfect it until the day when Christ returns. I've held on to this scripture all of my life. I wonder what scripture you hold on to as kind of an identifying kind of thing that God has given you. In my college years, I came to this little place called UCSB. You might have heard of it down the road. My pastor recommended to find a free Methodist church, and when I walked in the sanctuary, I was 20 years old, and I was like, this is home. I didn't plan to stay. That was not part of the plan. God planned that. I did not plan that. And over time, God asked if I'd be willing to serve him in that place, and I had to figure out, would I say yes? God met me in amazing ways in college. I had to find community because it was so big. I found a great campus fellowship group that taught me more about worship. Jesus matured me. I taught kids at church, and Jesus walked with me as I tried to figure out my path. You know that becoming an adult is not easy. Can I get an amen? Man, it is hard. You have to figure out who you are and the choices that you're going to make. The choices that are going to be different and the same as your family. You have to figure out what kind of work you're going to do and what kind of friends you're going to spend time with. You have to be responsible for yourself and for your decisions. You have to decide if you're going to be the same person wherever you go or if you're going to be double-faced so that people will like you. You have to decide if you're going to conform to the world around you and only love temporary things. You have to decide what you're going to do with Jesus. And all the while, your brain is still developing and your hormones are sometimes on fire and people are telling you their unsolicited opinions for what they think you should do with your life. You see, even though I decided to live for Jesus, the 20s were rough. They were a rough time. I was called, but I didn't know what that meant. I had to grapple with my past and let God heal me so that I could bring his healing to others. Man, it felt like a really long decade. But God met me again and again and protected me and guided me and forgave me and was patient with me. When I couldn't figure out which way to go, he brought me godly people to love me and pray for me and help me, and he made me wait. He made me wait so I would learn patience and know what his voice sounds like. He gave me time in the wilderness, not the first time, probably not the last time, so that I could be very aware of what his will was for me. You see, for me, deciding to be a pastor was like deciding whether or not to follow Jesus, except it was harder. Jesus tells us to count the cost. He tells us that if we love our lives, we will lose it. But if we love what he wants, then we will have abundant, overflowing life. And we're asked to deny what we want so that God might have glory. And then God just pours out this amazing, abundant life on us. Life is not easy, but God's presence makes it so full. And it was hard for me to be a pastor because of my brokenness, because I didn't know if I could do it. It was hard because women aren't always allowed to be pastors or honored in pastoring. It was hard because God didn't like have a sign above my head that said, do this. I had to seek him and I had people telling me what they thought. And so I waited and I listened and finally God spoke and God said this: who you are in me is more important than what you do for me. And until you figure that out, you are going to wander around in this desert place. Because I am the one who calls you by name, Colleen. I am the one who loves you. And I don't want you to be distracted by all of the other things that people are telling you to do or not do. And at this time, I just loved Romans 8 because it's such a picture of the church. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. Don't be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with the Lord's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. And I remember the day I said yes. I had been depressed. My husband would go to work. I would lay on the couch and I would cry. Could not figure it out, and God was so quiet. And I remember the day I said yes, and it was like, everything just opened up. Anchors are important because they keep boats and ships secure so that they don't drift aimlessly out into the open sea. Anchors keep vessels in one place so when the storms and the winds rage all around, they are not destroyed. When an anchor is in place, they say the ship is holding its ground. Anchors keep us attached to God metaphorically as the currents of the world try to move us in all directions. God has given us strong anchors in the faith. Scripture is one of them. What are your anchors in your life? I invite you to think about that. As you finish school for this year, maybe as you finish school overall for this season, God has given you a story. He has given you a voice. He has given so much because he has a plan for you, for your life. Your story is unique and good. So I want to say two last things. First, all of you have a call of God on your life to go and minister in the name of Jesus in some way. And I pray that no matter what that call is, that you will have such joy as you bring God's abundance life to others. God needs his people everywhere, in business and in the arts and in the academy and, of course, in the church. But go and do what God has uniquely gifted you to do and to be. Go be his boat. Lastly, I want to say that my mom and I found peace in my 20s right before she died. My dad came back to Jesus at the end of his life, and I got to be part of it. And I want to give you one last lesson, and it's this. God always holds out his hand to those who walk away. Don't ever forget that. All of our stories are still being written, and God continues to hold out his hands to all those who walk away. It doesn't matter. God's love is so good. So I want to invite you just to take a little moment to see what the Lord has said to you today. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Colleen. Let's do, as she said, let's take a moment, and as we sing this song, which is called Tu Fidelidad, or Your Faithfulness, just a short chorus, but you're welcome to sing along, or if this is a time for you to reflect and think about what some of those anchors are, and recall what God has done in your life, and maybe even rededicate yourself. This is the time. I know that the resident chaplains might be available for prayer in the corner, so if you see them, be up for prayer. And let's reflect on God's faithfulness.
Fidelidad es grande.
My fellow citizens, our pastor, Colleen, just gave us a great word on thinking about how we approach going. And this morning, we're going to celebrate how somebody has gone so faithfully right here in our midst. I'm speaking of the one and only great Canadian in our midst, Edie Schultze. Edie, when I think of what it is to answer a call and find a vocation, and that word vocation's way bigger than where you get your paycheck from, I look at your life of service and student development and student life, multiple colleges, you got to end at the best one, and you've just done it with all of your whole self. You brought your whole heart. You've offered relationship outside of the job. You have brought your joy, you've shared your struggles, and you've shared ours, and we are so grateful. And so we just want to celebrate that you're retiring this summer, so we have a little video, and the team can come up that's going to commemorate you, but we're just grateful for you. Congratulations.
Oh, that's such a great question. I love working here because... one, Westmont students. How long do you want me to talk? I love our students. Ambitious, smart, they love God, so creative. I love that what we do matters. It matters for the kingdom. It matters for people's lives. It gives me meaning. That's why I love working here.
Edie, we'd love to have you join us on stage. Okay. Hi, everyone. I'm Catherine. I've had the pleasure of meeting with Edie monthly this year throughout my role as student body vice president and her role as the VP of student life. And it has been such a blessing to learn from her in this capacity and see firsthand her care for us students and her adorable puppies. She has offered me such great encouragement, both professionally and personally, and I have treasured our time together. And it was also fun to have her join VK's Spring Sing Skit this year. Edie, thank you for your service to the college and for your love for us students. I am praying that you finish well and know how much you've impacted the Westmont community. I'm truly thankful to have gotten to know you this year, and congratulations on your retirement.
I met Edie 10 years ago when she started as our Vice President for Student Life, and over that time she's been my boss and has become my friend. Edie, I have learned so much from you, and I just want to mention three of the incredible assets you have provided to the Westmont community. First, you have spoken and lived with both truth and grace. It's unusual that somebody does both of those well, and you do, Edie. You've modeled leading with both. You've spoken hard words that are true, and yet, if you fail or mess up, there is so much grace in Edie's presence in Circle. Second, Edie is the queen of connections. She has cultivated strong professional relationships across the field, across the nation. She is well connected with other vice presidents, and they gain from her wisdom, and she gains richly from theirs. She's always sending out articles, things that about college student development that are the latest in the field, and we're always learning from Edie. She has the pulse on students and student life, and that's benefited you, and that's benefited us. Finally, Edie oversees student life team, which is about 35 staff, and she is very intentional about noticing the contributions of her team and directly affirming the good work that we do. She'll look you in the eye, and with a heartfelt word, she'll offer sincere thanks and words of affirmation that encourage us and spur us on to continue to do the good work that we strive to do. So for these things and many more, Edie, I want to thank you. We want to thank you for your faithful service here at Westmont these past 10 years. So.
I don't think I'm going to look at you. Just FYI. As someone who's had the privilege of working closely with Edie, very closely with Edie these last 10 years, I have a heart full of gratitude and admiration as I reflect on the profound and transformative impact you've had on Westmont and on me personally during your tenure as vice president. Edie, what sets you apart is not just your competence, but an authenticity and genuine desire to uplift and empower those around you that is deeply rooted in your calling from God. I can't tell you how many times I've heard Edie say to someone a version of the phrase, "God loves you and I have a plan for your life." And there's no question that that plan involved Edie helping them grow into a fuller and more complete version of who God created them to be. I know that firsthand. I've been an eyewitness to your leadership and unwavering dedication to students, and I can attest to the depth of your commitment to prioritizing student well-being in every decision that you make. Your work flows seamlessly from a deep sense of purpose, reflecting your faith and commitment to serving others. In moments of crisis, such as the Montecito debris flow and COVID-19 pandemic, a few things have happened during your time here. Your calm demeanor and steady thinking guided your decisions made with wisdom and discernment. Your ability to navigate complex situations with grace and resilience was a model for our student life staff as we served and supported students. Your leadership has been a testament to the transformative power of faith in action, inspiring those who've had the privilege of working alongside you. You lead by example, demonstrating a profound respect for diverse perspectives and a genuine concern for the well-being of each person under your care. Your trust in God's provision and your steadfast commitment to his calling have served as a source of strength and inspiration, and your leadership has left an indelible mark on those around you. Edie, as you embark on this new chapter in your life journey, know that your impact extends far beyond the confines of your time here. You have touched the lives of countless people, leaving behind a legacy of faith, compassion, integrity, and genuine care, and you will be sorely missed.
Edie, let me add my voice to the chorus of voices. It is just a delight to get to celebrate you, to surprise you. We should have sang the National Anthem of Canada in her honor. We still can, the walkout song. There are just so many elements to you that I have just so appreciated and just truly love and appreciate. You are a great professional. You just bring your whole being to all that you do as the VP of Student Life. You've set a great tone. You do amazing work to keep us in touch with all of the moving trends. Your summary of what students face are not only appreciated by the E-team and by the staff, but by people way beyond the boundaries of this college. And it's just a testimony to both your competence and your care with which you serve. Then you're a great teammate. I have loved the way in which you have been just a great part of the executive team and bringing joy, bringing challenge, all of us together really trying to serve the purposes of God and to do it together. But more than anything, I admire you because you are a devoted follower of Jesus Christ and it shows up. It shows up in the way in which you live, the way in which you discipline yourself, but also in the way in which you come back when you ask forgiveness and seek to make things right. Those are disciplines that only come with a long life lived in the same direction of obedience to the Lord. We don't know what God has in store for you. It'll be exciting to see all the new ways God empowers you in this chapter called retirement, but I'm sure you'll blaze a great trail. Finally, I want to conclude this morning with this memento of our appreciation for you. EDM Schultze, in honor and recognition of your 37 years of service as a student life professional at Wheaton, Bethel of Minnesota, and Westmont, including the final 10 years of your career as our beloved vice president, given this day by the Westmont community, April 17th, 2024. Edie, we love and appreciate you.
Thank you. I love this place. I will miss you. I see my Kapox Day women around and so many of you that I've journeyed with. Thank you for making it a joy. Caleb, I see you. Thank you for being responsive to what we're trying to do here. And I love watching you sing. I am going to miss that. When the band plays the music and you are fully in, wow. You're not just the future of the church, you are the church. You are the presence of Christ in the world. And I will continue to pray for you and ask that God will bring his kingdom on earth as you move and live and breathe and do your work wherever you are. I love you. I've been honored to serve here at Westmont. This is a great place, and I won't forget you. And I hope maybe you might remember me from time to time and pray. I'm going to be in Portland, Oregon, serving and working along, not doing anything professionally with Bridgetown Church, but contributing there with this, with what's happening. I'm just really excited about what's going on there. I've got some friends there. Bandit and Pippin get to come with me. And we're going to be walking in the rain a lot of the time. So thank you so much. God bless you.
Super quick announcement for you guys. Tomorrow night, 8:30 in the prayer chapel, join us for a time of worship and ministry hosted by Isla Vista Worship. I'd love to see as many of you there as possible.
Seniors, you have until noon today to go on the response thing and say that you're coming to senior chapel tomorrow night at the estate of Lindsay and Lori Parton, 6 o'clock, should be done by 8-ish. Dinner, worship, hearing from Kayla Peterson. It's going to be great. Open your hearts, your hands, receive the benediction. We heard a great word today about anchoring yourself in the Word of God. So I bless you to stand fast, to stand firm in the love of God for you and through you. Amen.
No, it's not. If you have time.